Hi, my name is Fritzi Horseman, and welcome to Compassion in Action. My guest today is Mark Moskowitz. Mark had a 28-year career in finance, including a time owning his own hedge fund. During a spiral in his life, Mark found himself pleading guilty to wire fraud for taking $700,000 of the fund's assets. He was sentenced to 33 months and went to Otisville Federal Prison. It was there that he learned about his trauma as a child that led to a life of low self-esteem and poor decision-making. Since his release in 2019, Mark has dedicated himself to teaching the principles he learned while incarcerated. He is a speaker, coach, CPP volunteer, and will be releasing his first book in the spring of 2022. Mark Moskowitz, welcome to Compassion in Action. I'm so excited to have you with us. You are a CPP volunteer, and we're so honored to have you working with us. And now we get to talk about your life in incarceration and in like a rebirth. And so can we start the conversation maybe telling us about your upbringing, where you came from, and then what happened and how you got to prison?
Sure. Thanks so much for having me on, Fritzi. It's really an honor to have met you and to meet Compassion Prison Project. And I love the work we're doing, and I'm happy to do as much as I can to help the movement.
Thank
you. So I grew up in New Jersey, a suburb of New York City, to a very solid family, good financial structure, both parents in the house. And what would look like on the outside is as quite an idyllic home. I went to a private school for high school, and we belonged to a country club. And like I said, on the outside, everything looked wonderful, looked great. But on the inside, there was a level of dysfunction that I was not so aware of growing up. But it really was there. It was a level of emotional neglect that wasn't there. I felt unloved by the two people that you expect to get the most love from. And because of that trauma, it affected the decisions that I made going forward in my life, because I was making decisions based on trying to please other people. I got into a career on Wall Street because that's what my father did. And I became a golfer because my father loved to play golf. So I wanted to spend time with him. He's my dad. And I knew that was the place to go. And so was Wall Street, if I wanted to impress him or please him. So I found myself living not really my life. I was kind of living their life all over again for them. And the fact is, these are all the lessons that I did learn during my incarceration. So I lived my entire life up to the age of 48, making decisions based on faulty wiring in my own brain. I got married at, I think, 28 years old, and we have three children. I'm divorced now, prior to my incarceration, but when I married someone to try and heal the relationship with my mother, and that really never works. In theory, you're tricking yourself into thinking that's the right way to go, but it didn't work, and it wasn't a wonderful marriage for either one of us. So, and I take much responsibility in that as well.
I just want to interrupt for a second, because one of the things about trauma and neglect, which is, neglect is emotional neglect is an adverse childhood experience. Mm-hmm. Neglect is one of the worst things for a child, because the child doesn't have a mirroring. He's not able to see himself reflected back. So his ideas and his authenticity is not mirrored back by his parents. And one of the things Gabor Mate talks about, how we have to choose between authenticity and attachment. And your story is a clear example of you choosing attachment over authenticity. So the combination of trying to get your parents' love and not knowing really what you were all about, because your parents couldn't reflect that back to you, is such an interesting from what I've learned, such an interesting thing to just reflect back to you, just to share with you.
It's such an incredible insight. And I always get a little bit emotional about it because I consider myself a smart person and intellectual and intelligent. And all those years I was like, what, why am I like this? Why I don't get it. And it really did lead to this spiral of just depression and unhappiness and never being authentic, always trying to be what you think the other person wants you to be. Even in some of the most simple relationships, just someone you've met on the street and have talked to for 5 minutes, you're like, why did I say that? Well, they don't know me, they don't care, but yet you're still seeking out other people's approval. So it really, and I don't know the exact, you probably know better than I do, but it's those young years, it's those early years that are so formative for us. And when we don't clear all that out, it just is going to haunt us forever, you know, and it did haunt me too, obviously, for quite some time.
Yeah. And it's not a clearing out. It's a child needs to be seen. That's our job as a parent, is to see our child and to say, look at you, so that they can know that when they go out into the world, that their instincts and their impulses are on point, that they can trust their own selves. But if your parents are too busy, and my parents were distracted with their divorce, with their trauma. And so I was neglected as well. And, you know, we're middle-class people growing up. Their kids, you know, they have physical neglect as well as emotional neglect, where they're not getting fed. They're not getting to the doctor, but this neglect, I mean, Romanian, just to give you an example, Romanian orphans, their brain, they scanned their brain and it shrunk by a third because of the neglect that they went through. And I bet you our brains shrunk as well, because we weren't getting the mirroring that a child needs. The same thing with everybody. Being seen is the key to our own development.
Yeah. You know, I don't want to jump too forward, but I just remember being in prison and never having any, like, never hugging anybody, you know, and just that, and I remember reading a study that said something along the lines of you need 5 to 10 hugs a day just to maintain emotional health. And it was just like this, I just remember thinking how sad that was for like 2 years, like never like really having a warm person to chat with or even like have a simple hug, you know, and it just, that conversation you were just saying kind of led me to that point a little bit.
Well, and I go into prison and my instinct, I actually wrote to a person in prison today. And I said, I want to give you a hug. We're not allowed as volunteers to give hugs. And, you know, emotional health, what a concept in prison, right?
You would think it would be paramount to these facilities, and it's, you know, hopefully you're bringing that message to them, but it's not there. It's not there right now. Not there yet.
Well, I'm really glad you said 5 to 10 hugs. 'Cause you know, I need 5 to 10 hugs I need to give my kid 5 to 10 hugs a day. Right. And my husband.
Yeah.
I mean, this is for everybody listening. Yeah. Let's not be greedy on our hugs. We can't be stingy on the hugs.
Yeah. No, give them out freely. They're free, right?
Yeah. Mark. You know, you learn something every day. You never know where you're going to learn it. It's just so, and it's just more enrichment. I feel richer already talking with you.
Oh, that's great. So, you know, kind of going back again now, yeah. So growing up with this lack of authenticity, lack of really being able to be myself. And then what ultimately happened, probably as I got into my 20s and 30s and early 40s, was this wall built up around me of this lack of trust. You know, so I wasn't, I felt like I had a lot of friends, I had family, I had what I looked like, okay, I have all these people in my life, yet I really had nobody because I didn't trust in myself to trust them. So there was this deep lack of trust. And when my life really started to go south, I had really felt so alone. And not that I could chat with anybody about anything that was going on and open up about the anger and the depression and all the negative emotions that I was feeling, you know, and then that all just kind of kept manifesting into putting myself on this emotional island where everything looked just like my family growing up, everything looked great on the outside, but on the inside, there was a firestorm going off, and not knowing how to handle it at all was just really difficult time for me.
Well, and you bring up the word trust, and it sounds like what you did, your crime of $700,000, is that what happened?
Yeah.
So you embezzled that for yourself, or?
I was managing a hedge fund, and I used kind of in and out, like back and forth. I would take some and I'd put it back, and I'd take some and put it back. And eventually it got to that point where it was just too much to put back. So it was about 700,000. At that point, I was already going through my divorce. I was single and having a good time, as sometimes you do, especially when you leave a marriage with all this emotional damage and you don't see it again, because you're not just being inauthentic to other people. Maybe the worst crime of all is being inauthentic to yourself, right? So lying to yourself and telling you everything is great. Oh my goodness, thank goodness I finally got out of this marriage, and I'm going to go out and have a good time. And I've had a good time, what looked like a good time, but it wasn't. And I wasn't taking care of my business, and bills still had to come in and get paid. So I did what I shouldn't have done. So I took some money from the fund. Yes.
And so to me, that's what I call, what I tell the guys, that's a shenanigan. But the shenanigan to me is a betrayal of the self. Ultimately, it's the betrayal of the self. It's something you know you shouldn't do, and you do it anyway, right?
Yes. And it does go back to that concept of, oh, I can put it back. I know how to make money. I've made money my whole life. And of course, it is this love of this money, this always constantly, always chasing all of this outside of yourself, right? We're chasing these material items. We're chasing fame and fortune that has really nothing to do with ourselves feeling good, but we think it's going to replace all those empty feelings that we have. So, you know, you are shenanigan. You are betraying yourself, and you constantly are just in this huge roller coaster of emotions, you know. And as a Wall Street person, as a trader, you're just like, emotions are what you deal with. Like, you just learn to live with the ups and downs of huge swings every day. So you just think you're used to it, and that you'll put it all back, and no one will be the wiser, and everything will just be fine. But at some point, you do have to pay the piper, and everything does kind of come tumbling down very quickly.
And you know, they say that these acts, these things we do to ourselves, because I'm guilty of shenanigans too, believe me. And I, during one of my jobs as a post supervisor, I sent out something I knew that wasn't perfect. And when you're a post supervisor, it's got to be perfect. And I knew it was imperfect, but I just, you know, I think we betray ourselves sometimes so we can stop what we're doing, because what we've done, taking the job as a hedge fund person, might have been a betrayal from that point. I'm wondering if even being a hedge fund manager was a betrayal to yourself.
I think so. I could have continued to stay in a pretty comfortable position. I was in sales at UBS, Union Bank of Switzerland, and I could have just lived a very comfortable, easy life. But I think there was this kind of desire to blow it all up, the subconscious desire that said, you know, you're not worthy of happiness. You're not worthy of the things you have in your life. And, you know, again, going back to that childhood trauma, you know, if you were worthy, your parents would have been there for you. If you were worthy, you know, X, Y, and Z would have happened. So I do think there is that self-sabotage mode that we go into when we just don't feel that we're worthy of what we see in front of us. We tend to want to blow it up.
Absolutely. That's it. And I blew, just like I did, I blew it up. But it's also, I mean, it's also a cry for attention. You know, if no one's going to see me, I'm just going to screw it all up, right?
You're spot on. Again, it's just like, it's the child who will take the negative attention. At least if you spank me, you're at least you're paying attention to me. You're not neglecting me. You have to take at least 5 seconds to notice me, right? And I think that's a huge part of it. Yes, I'll take any attention I can get.
Exactly. And you know, one of the things we're working on is teaching people to put their trauma glasses on. So you see someone as manipulative, you put your trauma glasses on, and it's just, they're trying to figure out how to get their needs met in a way that they've met them before. Or they're lazy. Well, they're immobilized. They're not lazy. They can't figure out how to do anything. So we put our trauma glasses on for you. And, you know, someone who just, you know, shot himself in the foot, he's really just asking mom and dad to appreciate him. I mean, and I think that's a fundamental need. That's a fundamental need for all of us. And that's why we have Donald Trump doing his shenanigans and, you know, people storming the Capitol and people being woke, because they're not, no one is getting the fundamental need of just having a mother saying, you're amazing.
And yeah, I love that. It's so true. I mean, I think, you know, not to get political, but I think we focus so much on the things that we can't control, especially in politics. You know, like I could ask people, obviously, who the Senate minority leader and majority leader, but do you even know who's on your city council? You know, that's where you have, that's, it's those grassroots, that's where you have power. You know, stop focusing on people who are thousands of miles away from you. Start focusing on the people who are in your own town, who really can wield some power. And that should be how we live our lives when it comes to charitable organizations and helping out, is at the, I think it says, think locally and or think globally, act locally, right? That's right. Such a beautiful saying. And we need to really be doing that. And it's empowering to know that you can make a difference and that you can make a choice. And that's such a big message, such a big message.
But the locally goes even further, because changing the world starts with you, right? Changing the world starts with, how am I being violent to myself? How am I, what are the shenanigans I'm doing today? Or if there are any, what am I not honoring in myself? Because by taking that hedge fund job, now to me, people who work in Wall Street, you know, they were little boys and little girls, and they never woke up and said, Daddy, I want to be a hedge fund manager. Or maybe they did, but
few of them, yes.
Really think about that. But I think on some level, they lost who they were on the way, searching for something that would give them the simple reflection that we all need. And but by doing that, by betraying themselves in the choice of picking hedge fund manager, and this is just my opinion, and maybe it's not true for you, but to me, hedge funds and people who are on Wall Street, they're not creating anything. They're actually kind of manipulating things and moving things around and trying to get the best out of things for their gain, for their clients' gain. And by doing that, they don't understand the repercussions down the line. There are other people that are suffering from these decisions they're making. There's arbitrage and all that. So in a sense, there's like a blind destruction that's happening in hedge funds, in banking, because it's not taking the whole picture into consideration. It's taking the bottom line into consideration. And so in a sense, it's violence to the earth. It's violence to the community that they're not aware of. I mean, no, we're not even thinking about it, but that's why one of the things I say is we're responsible for everything. Is if I'm taking a job, what is my job and what are the repercussions of my job? When I was working in the film industry, we were working with chemicals way back when. So we were creating chemicals. What were we doing with those chemicals? I don't know, but if I was fully responsible, I would be concerned down to that level. Or what is the content? Are we creating violence? Is this activating other people's, and I'm sorry, this is your podcast, but
it's okay. We can banter about this.
Just the violence that we put in that we don't even know about because we've stopped taking the whole picture in. And I think that's what I think you forgot as you were chasing the gold ring.
Well, I think one of the things that's kind of coming into my mind when listening to you says, like, it's amazing what we can get used to as people, you know, like I got used to being in this marriage that was not healthy for me. I got used to living, you know, in a career that I didn't love. And look, Wall Street is not an altruistic place. And it was much better 40 years ago, but, and it's definitely gone down. There are some pieces to it that help society, but for the most part, it's, it's a small sliver compared to perhaps what they're taking out of society. And by the way, what they take out of individual, because individuals like myself, because you do sort of get taught to step over the line and then come back real fast and step over the line again and come back real fast. So, you know, you do chip away at someone's moral character over time. But I just think it's like what I was saying, it's so amazing what we get used to and, you know, and it could be, it's like a Stockholm syndrome where you fall in love with your captor, you know, because you just get used to that and you would rather have that than not have anything at all. So it's this hopeless desperation.
Yes. But you're taking that step that, like, it's your responsibility to say, wait a second. And that's it. It's, you know, and I'm not casting blame on you. I'm saying, but that's what got you there. You got inured, you got numbed out to the fact that you were stepping over the line all the time.
Well, that's really my third principle, is taking responsibility. And to touch on that point, one of the things that I really like, I mean, I dug deep into prison, you know, like one of the, when I surrendered in September of 17, there was a part of me that had this relief, because I was thinking, okay, they know what to do. I haven't been able to fix myself all these years. They know what to do. And I got there, and within about a week, I realized that they don't know anything. They have no idea what to do. I'm like, oh my God, Mark, this is on your own again. Here you are, like, you're on your own. But for me, the benefit was at least actually being out of society, not having my cell phone, not having to have all the responsibilities, gave me some extra time to do what I wasn't really able to do on the outside. But that was really like this big freak out moment for me. Like, oh my goodness, like, what am I going to do? And I just really dug in. I dug in deep and I just didn't know where to begin. And so I began with one thing that had always kind of resonated, and I was never great at it because I just, again, don't think my self-worth was there. But I just started with gratitude. And because I remember reading books by like Tony Robbins and Jim Rohn and a lot of the people like that, a lot of religions talk about gratitude. I didn't know where to start. So I just started taking these gratitude walks every day. And I would walk for an hour and I would just say anything that popped into my head. I'm grateful for trees and I'm grateful for the blood that flows through my body, whatever I could say. And at first I was really faking it. I was just kind of BSing my way along on these walks. But after a couple of months, something really magical happened. And I became grateful, like, for everything. Like, it was just like, you know, the neuroplasticity in our brain, the more we tell ourselves something, the more we're going to believe and the more we're going to become it. And I really felt like that primed my mind for a lot of change. And I just was digging deep into books and I was reading and I was really doing the work. I was meditating and I was going back to my childhood and I was taking like one event and bringing it through years and years up and seeing like, why did that event affect me? And it was some really deep, hard work, very hard work, but it was very worthwhile too.
I mean, that's the thing about prison. It's the one thing I've learned about watching the guys I've met who are light years ahead of many of us. If you get into conversations with them, mm-hmm. you have the time to just few distractions. I mean, and it sounds like, you know, you were in a no level prison.
I was in a camp. Yeah. I was in a
prison. You were in a camp.
Yeah.
So there was no gate there, right?
There was no gate. No. And we weren't in jail cells. We were in a dormitory style sleeping facility. And there was really minimal physical danger. It was really the emotional toll. And you're really also living in a place where what's to me a very sad part of it is there was a very small percentage of people who really wanted to fix themselves. They didn't, most people didn't try. And since the system's not forcing you to try, they figured I'll just go out my day playing gin and chess and watching TV and I'll spend my time however I spend my time. There was that small percentage of people and we all ended up hanging out together because, you know, birds of a feather flock together, right? So all the people who really wanted to dig in and do that work, we had these little groups together and it was very, very helpful.
So you get into prison. When is the day you're like, well, you actually knew you had to fix yourself when you walked in, right? You
thought I was very motivated. I mean, my relationship with my children was sinking already, and I knew that I needed to get them back in my life, and that the only way to do that was to come out a much better person. But then, of course, it was for myself too. I had been searching most of my adult life, as I alluded to back before. I didn't know how my life had become such a mess, and I needed to figure that out. I needed to leave there with at least that one answer. I didn't know how I was going to get it. I had no idea, no blueprint. I trusted in the universe that I would figure it out. And thank goodness I did.
And how did you figure it out? What were your steps? What did you do? Give us some guidance, because we all need this.
It began with gratitude. I mean, I told you that story, and that was it. That, you know, because when you start to take on the attitude of gratitude, you do change the way you see things, right? And as Wayne Dyer says, when you change the way you look at things, the things you look at change. So I started going from this anger and from this upset and from blaming others and all these other things to seeing everything as beautiful and a gift and just being grateful for it. And it took time. I mean, it takes effort. Anyone who says that you can do 6-minute abs, it's not 6-minute abs. It's like, you got to watch your diet and you got to go to the gym and you got to do everything you got to do. It's the same thing. You have to put in the time, but it's so worthwhile. It is so worth it, because now I'm on the other side of it, and I just live every day with this just happiness. And I am just truly grateful for everything. And then the serendipity of what happens when you start to become changing your mind. Like, so I read a book. I read a book by Nathaniel Brandon, The 6 Pillars of Self-Esteem. And I think it was written in the 90s. Very good book. Thick, though, like a workbook, like a real book that you had to dig through. And he gave you exercise at the end of each chapter. But it started getting me to understand self-worth and self-image and self-esteem. And it was like resonating with me, like, okay, I kind of get that. I wasn't authentic. And I used to bend the truth or all out lie or whatever it was. And so I finished that book. And then I was talking to someone at the camp, another person who was doing some hard work on himself. And then he's like, you know, you might like this book too. And it was a book called Real Power by a man named Dr. David Lieberman. And boom, I read like the first 5 pages and it just hit me. Like, you know how sometimes something, you can hear the same message, but from 2 separate messengers. And for some reason that second messenger might hit it. And everything just changed for me, just like that. And I understood self-esteem and I understood ego. And like all the dominoes started falling in the right direction for the first time in my life. You know, when you're searching for that answer and you finally get it, it is just a feeling of so much heaviness coming off of you. And I really felt it like within an instant, you know, really quickly. So it was self-esteem. It was my self-image was low. I suffered with this unhealthy self-image because going back to people-pleasing, going back to feeling emotional neglect growing up.
Yeah. But what you're talking about is grace, right? Isn't that a moment of grace?
That was a big moment of grace. Yes. I finally did start to, once my self-esteem was rising to a healthy level, I was able to forgive myself on a deeper level. And again, that was very cathartic for me. So it started with gratitude. It turned into self-esteem. And from there, like I said, the third thing that really came to me was responsibility, because once I started to understand about how the ego likes to protect us, so the ego will do whatever it can to make us feel good about ourselves, even if it's complete lies, right? So the ego is going to say, no, that's Fritzy's fault. That's not your fault, Mark. You didn't do that. That was her fault, or that's your mother and dad's fault, whatever. But once you start to take on this level of responsibility, what I call extreme responsibility, where you know that you own your power. Nobody can tell me how to feel. Nobody can tell me what to think anymore. I choose and I create what I want. And that is the most liberating of feelings. And you know what happened? What happened was I forgave everybody. And even more than that, I came to this conclusion, that my parents did the best they could. They weren't trying. And it wasn't even forgiveness. It was what I call absolution. I absolved them from any wrongdoing because they just did the best they could. They weren't trying to hurt their son. They weren't, there was no nefarious plot against me, even though it felt like that for all those years. And I just owned my own power. And now I know that, and this is not, I'm not talking about this in a selfish or a way where you don't give out to people, but I just know that I can choose the way I react to someone else's comment, you know, and that's such a, and I'm tested almost every day being someone with a criminal record. I've been rejected by so many women for dates. I've been rejected by so many jobs, but yet I choose to look at it as another test and something that I just have to overcome. And I'm going to keep moving on and I'm going to keep being the best self that I can be. And it's, I love it. It's liberating.
Yeah. You know, there's a few things I want to say. There's a third of the population is justice involved, right? So, I mean, the women who you were dating or you were, you know,
who meeting. Are checking, let's say meeting,
who you're meeting, they're really limiting their possibilities. I'm just letting you know. They're,
of course.
It's short-sighted on their part. But, you know, we have this stigma about criminality, and I would say we're all criminals. We all have, we've all done things that are against the law. Like even if it's a penny on your taxes, you're still breaking the law, right? Or even if you're driving home with three drinks, mm-hmm. and you know, it's your blood alcohol level is probably in the range. Mm-hmm. We still do it. And so who are we to judge? And then on the other part, if we're judging that hard, how are we judging ourselves? But one of the cool things you just said was about, I can't remember it now, but it was about how you're perceiving yourself. It was, It was just so cool. Like,
yeah. I mean, look, I know who I am now. Like, I know I'm a good person and I know I have a great heart and I know I care about people. Like that was, I think this dichotomy in my brain that I could never reconcile was like, I always felt like I was this good person, but why would a good person do the things I did? Right. So it was like this struggle, internal struggle, like, Mark, you're a good person. But on the other hand, now you're doing something that you need to go to prison for. So, but now I know that I am a good person. Like there's not a question in my mind. Like it's just who I am. My parents did actually raise me with some good values. I just needed to get past all of the stuff that was clouding my thinking and all that faulty wiring. And I did. And you know, thank goodness I did. Now I'm spreading the message, hopefully.
Well, faulty wiring, but also it was faulty wiring. Your parents were checked out, but we also have to think, and I love that you use the word absolve them, because that's true responsibility. You're taking responsibility for your life from birth to death. But, you know, I'm with you on that, but I also have to talk about child abuse or child neglect, which, you know, I thought about your parents, they're from a Jewish heritage, right?
Yes.
So Jewish people have been, dealt a real raw hand for generations. I mean, currently we're Jews have a much better life now, but the traumas that they experienced and that their parents experienced, just World War II and just even being a Jewish person in the United States during World War II, they're dealing with a lot of trauma that isn't expressed, isn't talked about, but checking out is a trauma response and not dealing with what you know is wrong or know is troubling is a trauma response. And I'm not saying that they even knew it on an intellectual level, but they checked out and it's a legacy. It's an intergenerational trauma that you're dealing with as well. I see it in my other Jewish friends, and you know, I'm part Jewish, so, but I have, that's a whole nother story.
You know, so a bit of a sad part of the story was my father passed away while I was in prison. And that was rough. And despite some of the things that I learned, we did have a good relationship. He and I had the best relationship of the three children. Obviously I worked hard at it going into the same career as him and all that. But, you know, as I'm starting to make these revelations, right, and as my self-esteem is rising and as I'm feeling better about things and forgiving and moving through this, you know, chain of emotional healing, I did happen to have this epiphany that my father really struggled to. He had his own demons. And to your point, exactly that, you know, when he was back in, when, you know, back in the 30s and 40s, you know, they didn't talk about this, even probably the 50s and 60s, they really didn't talk much about it. So, you know, so he had his own demons that he dealt with. And that also helped me to move away from this feeling of anger and disappointment, and to really, like, to this point of love, you know, like, I felt so much compassion for him, especially as his last days were not great days, you know. And I'm happy to say also that a byproduct of my own healing has been this wonderful resurgence with my mother. We have in the last year and change, we have cultivated this most amazing relationship, one I never would have imagined. And I believe it's because I healed myself that she was able to meet some of the requirements that I needed for us to continue to have this relationship. And I know people struggle out there, and I know that there is many, many types of abuses that I never suffered. And going to back to your point is you take responsibility, but only for your reaction now after the fact. You cannot take responsibility for an adult doing something to you. That is not exactly what I'm trying to say. So I want to make that point clear.
I agree with that. And I didn't mean it like that.
Yeah, no. And I'm glad that you kind of got me thinking that way, because there are people out there who deal with all, I mean, I started crying. I was watching one of the trauma circles, and I think a few of the men had all 10 of them. And that was just so heart-wrenching to me. And actually I felt a level of guilt for having, you know, only two, you know, and still feeling like my life, you know, was a mess up. So I can only imagine what these people have gone through, and it is not their fault. So when I talk about responsibility, the healing part of it becomes when you can look back at your past, however horrific it might be, and you can choose how you want to feel about that when you're healthier emotionally. So I want to make that point hopefully clear.
Yeah, but I want to also let you know, neglect is one of the worst things a parent can do to their child. So, you know, they may have 10, which includes neglect, but it's one of the worst things, because again, your brain is not getting mirrored. It's like being in solitary confinement. And it's, I mean, and you know the damage that solitary does to the people. I mean, psychosis, you know, all kinds of symptoms. And so we have to think, we can never compare our pain to other people's pain. And then that's one of the things. It's like, Brené Brown talks about it, is like, my pain has no value, because look at that mother just lost her child. It's like, no, your pain is just as relevant, as just as important as their pain. And it's wonderful you have empathy for them as well, but it's okay to have pain and have, and live in this life. This is the Buddha's message, is that we're here, suffering is part of what we have to do. It's our job, I guess, to suffer in a sense, so we can learn about the nooks and crannies of our being.
Yes. We grow through suffering, without a doubt.
Exactly.
Know, and I've chosen to take that to a physical level too, because I like to run. I like to run distances. So, you know, to me, I love like putting my body on the line, because I think that is a spiritual practice as well. And it helps me to flush out some of those negative thoughts that might be popping in. So I'm a firm believer that we grow from our suffering, but we have to be aware of what is causing our suffering. And then we have to work to come up with a solution to that suffering. You know, if for me, I held on to a trauma from 40 years ago, right? When I talked about being comfortable in our misery sometimes, right? I was more comfortable there than talking it through with a therapist. So it took me going all the way to prison for me to really be able to come to grips with all of that. So you need to be aware, you need to be willing to reflect on it, and then you really need to change, maybe reframe your own thought process to it, you know, and look at it as something that horrible that happened, but now it's made you this better, stronger person that you can deal with something And, you know, for me, I had this moment in prison where I knew I had to tell the things I learned. If it was to one person or to 10 or a million, I don't know, but I knew I needed to tell it somehow. And that's why I'm so thankful for being able to do that through this.
Yeah. But the thing is, I don't think you knew you were traumatized. I don't think in those 40 years, 100%. You didn't know. No. I didn't know I was traumatized till I was 56. And I mean, it changed my life, that information. And that's why I'm doing what I do, because I just want everyone to know. It's like, wait a second, you're not a bad person. You're not crazy. You're not out of your mind. You might be, but that's because you're traumatized.
Right. We have to tell it because there's so many people out there that are suffering in silence, right? They're suffering. They don't know where to turn. Just like me, I had nobody to talk to. I had no idea to talk about what, you know. I've gone to therapy, but it never worked because they never got me there. They wanted to talk about things that I didn't even know to talk about. So I think when the layperson tells their story of, you know, the hero's journey, right? Where we fall from grace and then we come back better than ever. That is the most healing thing I think we can do.
Well, when I'm in prison, I always ask the guys, how many people would be alive if you weren't in prison? How many people would be dead if you weren't in prison? And most of them raise their hands. And so to me, you know, prison is a big timeout. It's a place where, I mean, and a lot of people don't do the work and they don't want to do the work, but it's a place where you can really discover yourself. And it's a time, you don't really have time on the outside to do it.
We have to adjust sentencing, and I'm no expert on sentencing, other than the people that I met who had longer sentences than me or shorter sentences than me. I happen to feel I was sentenced to 33 months. In the federal system, you serve 85% of that. So I served 2 years in the camp and then 4 years on home confinement. For me personally, that was like the right amount of time, because it takes a few months to get acclimated to where you are. And then it takes some time to really do the work. I think had I gotten 7 or 8 years, I probably would not have even thought about doing the work for at least 4 or 5 years. And who knows by then, maybe by then I'm already in trouble and I'm in a medium and, you know, like, who knows? So we have to figure out the right sentence for people. If you're too far away from the door, it's hard to know, you really, what are you going to do the work for? You know, if you're too close, if you come in with a 3-month sentence, then, you know, you're in and out. You don't even realize it. You know,
but like you said, half those guys, they have longer and shorter sentences and they're just playing cards, right?
Yeah.
And playing chess. So they're not even working on themselves.
Oh, it's so sad.
So I don't know if it's about sentencing. I agree, sentencing reform is important, but I think it's also about having awareness, having programs that, first of all, tell you about trauma, but also tell you about how great you are and how great you can be, and how great thou art. You know, there's that song, "How Great Thou Art." And that's how I feel about everybody in the world. I wrote this to the guy in prison today, just how great thou art. And to let them know this so that they have a chance to discover this. This is the thing. It's about mirroring. And if what people see, what you see back, you know, I see Mark, he's a beautiful man. He's, you know, the one thing I see is that you're dating these girls that want a rich hedge fund guy, and that's not you anymore.
Yeah.
So I think you have to.
By the way, going back to that one topic, it's a wonderful filter, because I know that if you're compassionate or not right off the bat, you know, your profile might say, oh, I'm spiritual, I do yoga, and I'm very compassionate. And then as soon as I tell you, you bolt away. So it's a very good filter for me. I don't have to waste too much time on these women.
The gefilte.
Nice. I like it. Very good. Very good.
Yeah. I mean, that's the thing. What it's so great. I'm hearing this, and this is me mirroring back what I just heard in a different way, is I hear that you're so clear about who you are. It doesn't matter anymore. So what you're really looking for is a true companion and a true partner. And that's not who you married, from what I can tell. Is she was going for the hedge fund guy.
I'm not going to disparage her.
No, I know.
It was a relationship, both is 50-50, but right. Yes, of course. I mean, we all grow up thinking we're going to have X, Y, and Z, and sometimes it gets taken away from you.
But also that's a Jewish thing. He's a nice Jewish boy. He's got a good job. He's good, sure. But yeah, that's all from the trauma. That's a trauma thing. Cause he should be a doctor. He should be a lawyer, right? All those things.
Sure.
That's a trauma thing because security is so important and money is so important in a traumatized, traumatized society, but also a traumatized generations.
I've met some really great people also. I don't want to just disparage some people, but I've met some amazing people. And I'm always impressed for the person who does go the road less traveled and sort of bucks away from that trauma. That person who says, yes, your grandparents, you have to marry a Jewish woman and you have to be a doctor, you have to be a lawyer, whatever. And they buck it, and they go do their own thing and they strike out on their own. I've always had this just amazing feeling every time I was around somebody like that, and following their passion and pursuing what they feel is their purpose. And when you're a kid, you're young, and we make these huge decisions when we're 18 and 19, and what are we going to do, what school are we going to go to, what are we going to study, and all these things, and we're so ill-equipped for that. Sometimes that was some of my anger towards my parents, is how come you didn't direct me better or something like that. But again, it's gotten me to this point. And that is what is just, I do wake up every day. I mean, the first thing I get up, I say a prayer of thanks to God. And then I go over some things that I'm thankful for, people and places and events and other. And it's just just puts you into this amazing state right away. And I just carry it on throughout the day. And when I put my head on the pillow at night, I sleep so well. And I know that I've done so much hard work, and I've cried and I've been depressed and I've been as low as I can. And now I'm in this really nice, steady state. And I just wish I could bottle it and give it to people. It's the best place to live. It really is.
Well, a couple of things just occurred to me. You were saying, I wish I could have been that guy that didn't follow the program, the menu of being Jewish, but you kind of did. You kind of said, I'm going to break the law so I can
sure.
I can get out of this rut.
We're going to blow it up, like we said earlier, right? Going to blow it up.
Exactly. I mean, yeah. I think prison has been your rebirth.
100%, 100%. And these conversations that you and I are having right now, this is what people need. They need to talk. They need to just talk it out. And there is a way to get to the places that we live in our minds. I mean, emotionally, not physically. Talk is such a great thing. And what the work that we're doing is, it's imperative. It's really imperative.
Well, what is it? Community brings immunity, right?
I love that. Yeah, that's great.
Yeah. I don't know who said it, but when I heard it, I was like, hello, that's fantastic, because that's well-being, community, being heard, being seen. Again, it's about being seen. And that's
I said before, I felt so lonely in my spiral. I felt so lonely. And now, because I've broke down that wall that wouldn't let me trust, right? Now I let everybody in, and now I can trust everyone, and everyone feels like a close friend to me. In the greatest of ways. And I feel like, I can be so authentic. And you know what? We were talking about a little bit. I did meet a woman recently and I told her the story. She goes, okay, so you made a mistake. No big deal. So it's but I was so, and she was refreshed because I was still willing to be open about it. And then she actually opened up to me about a few things. So it was nothing going to prison, but she had some things that I think she felt in a safe, comfortable place to talk about it. So I find that when I sort of purge myself to people, that breaks down their walls. And then they can kind of come back to me with things that they maybe wouldn't open up to somebody about so quickly.
Yes, because you're being authentic and you're allowing other people to be authentic, and you're showing them what authenticity looks like. And so they can be authentic. They're in a safe place to be authentic. That's attachment and authenticity, right? You can bond That's why circles are so important, because you can be authentic. And that's, you're reclaiming yourself. That's like, you know, it's another miracle, another prison miracle.
It's amazing. Amazing.
So I know we kind of started the conversation asking, I wanted it like a play by play, and we got like hints of what happened, but I want to move into your coaching and what you're doing with your coaching, and maybe some tips to the listeners of, I know you said being responsible, which I agree. I'm 100% responsible for everything if I can be, but what are some other tips, and what do you do with your in your coaching?
Sure. So my coaching is a combination of personal and business. So I try to help people consult with them to get them to first figure out maybe why they're not having the success that they want. And if they are having the success they want, are they having the life balance that they really need? You know, for me growing up, it was about making money, and charity was simply writing a check, which is great. And charities need money for sure. But it's also like, you know, actually putting yourself out there for an hour or 2 weeks is also a really nice thing to do, right? So I try to get people to explore some work-life balance. And what most people find when we dig deep into sort of their daily routine is that they're wasting a lot of time because they don't have a systematic way to handle their business. So what's taking them really 10 hours in time really could be done in five and 6 hours, which gives them a lot more time to maybe pursue a passion, be with their family a little bit more, be more present-minded. You know, one of the things that was, I think, the worst part of when I was really hitting the skids was I was never present focused. You know, when I was with my kids, I was thinking about work. And when I was at work, I was thinking, oh my gosh, I need to be with my kids. I was never like right here where I'm with you. Like I was never in that moment. So I really try to help people figure out the systems so they can find that work-life balance. And a lot of it does come like when we hit roadblocks in our earnings or in our happiness in our marriage, it's because we're struggling often with self-image and self-worth. So we try to dig deep into that too, in terms of, okay, what's, you know, where can you start to raise your self-worth? And a lot of times it's really simple sometimes. Like if you're already fairly healthy self-esteem wise, sometimes it's just having a difficult conversation with somebody. Maybe it's having a difficult conversation with your manager. You know, I'm not being tested enough at work. I need a little bit more responsibility. Or maybe it's having a conversation with your significant other, you know, that you're maybe not feeling exactly a priority in their life. And sometimes those simple conversations and just helping sort of role playing how those conversations can go become really cathartic. And, you know, within a few months, people start to, their lives really start to pick up. So I'm a big person about systems. I believe that goals are wonderful and that you have to have goals so you know where you're going. But ultimately, it's the systems that you have in place that get you there. And habits, habits and systems kind of go together. So my life to others might look very monotonous, but to me, it's wonderful because I don't have to make so many decisions in the day. Like I know that when the alarm goes off, often I get up before the alarm, but when it goes off, I know exactly how I'm going to start my day, you know, and I do that every day. And it keeps me very grounded and it keeps me feeling great. So you'd be shocked at like how much of that, like that's like 80% of the work I do is just getting people to get there. And then it's just making some fine tunes and some tweaks to get them the rest of the way. But and I love doing it. I really love helping. And it's just been a great journey for me.
Isn't that amazing? You know, from like destroying the earth to now like helping people be their best selves. And in the process, watching yourself be your best self.
It is. And self-esteem, self-image, it's not something where, I mean, I think again, for me, I fooled myself in thinking I just needed this one big event to happen. Having a good self-image is doing the little steps every day. You know what? If you want to lose weight, it's not having the chocolate cake, you know, or it's only having it once a month as opposed to having it every night. You know, it's the small little steps that we do every day. And that's what helps you really build your self-confidence because you see little wins. It's not about these gigantic, huge boulders that you have to push uphill every day. It's little wins all day long.
It's true. It's true. It is little wins. I mean, it's nice to get the big wins too sometimes, but.
Well, the big one, it's that, you know, when you get a lot of little wins, the big wins happen, right? So it's, but the big wins are what? Maybe a couple times a year, if even that. So if you're always waiting for the big wins, your life is passing you by. Why, you know, the journey, like for someone like me, obviously, like I always was focused on the end goal. Now it's like every day I'm in that present moment and I'm focusing on the journey part of it. And I know where I would like to go. I know where I want to get to, but I'm just so soaking up every moment of the journey too. Why can't I have it all? You know,
it's so nice. It's, you know, it sounds so cliche, just, you know, just enjoy every moment, but it's true, right?
We choose what to do in each moment. Every moment is a test for us to make a choice. And if someone cuts you off when you're driving, you have a choice. You can give them the finger, or you could say, okay, they might be having a bad day and I'll let it go, right? Very simple.
I used to give them the finger. Now
most people did.
Yeah, now it's getting better. Now I'm like, oh, what's going on with him?
Exactly. As we healed ourselves, right? Dot, dot, dot.
Gosh, it's, you know, it's the same conversations always, the same texts, the same books say the same thing, but it's always refreshing to hear it from another person, isn't it?
Yeah. And as I said, something resonates with everybody in some way. You know, we put out this energy to each other, and sometimes we repel some of that energy, and sometimes we really magnetize ourselves with it. So, and we don't always know exactly why, but the more people who are spreading the good word of what we're talking about, is that gives us more opportunities to heal ourselves and to heal our friends and to heal the world along with it.
Well, I think we should end here, Mark. It's the perfect ending. Thank you so much for your wisdom and your perspective. We got to talk about your book. Tell us about your book.
All right. So I tried to write a book a million different times and I failed, but I finally found this really amazing course online, and I've been writing this book. So I just got the first manuscript through, and it's got a publishing house that's going to help publish it. And it's going to be out in April or May of 22. The book is titled Within: How I Found My Authentic and Happy Self in Federal Prison. And the message is a lot of what we discussed. And the overarching theme here is, the reason why I chose that title of Within is that we have everything within ourselves to live the life we want. We have the confidence and the self-esteem. It's all right there. Everyone is smart enough. Everyone has enough knowledge and intelligence. You just have to let it shine. And you just have to be willing to know that it's there. And step by step, you build into it, and it is a beautiful view from up here. So that'll be out in spring, and I'm really excited. It's been a great journey writing that as well. It's a lot of ups and downs, you know, a lot of sitting in the seats and just typing, and sometimes typing gobbledygook, but just to have the physical action of writing is incredible. And getting the words out on paper it's both exhilarating and exhausting at the same time.
So 4 years out of prison, I mean, no, 2 years out of prison.
2 years out.
But 4 years since you walked into prison, mm-hmm. and you already have a book. Like, that's pretty cool, right?
It's awesome. Yeah.
How many people want to write a book?
I tried. I told you I tried. And through a very, I don't believe in coincidences anymore. I believe everything's preordained, right? I met somebody on LinkedIn who showed me that this is how they figured out how to write it through this course. And they introduced me to it. And it's been just such a blessing to write it. So yeah, looking back, it's you could never put the dots together. It's all by some beautiful life force, some beautiful power, whatever you want to call it, whether it's God or the universe or something else. That's everyone's personal decision, but I know it's out there, and I know you have to have faith and trust in it.
It's a divine plan. I mean, prison was a divine plan for you.
100%.
I mean, look 100%. At you. You're sparkling.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
And we need sparkling. We need sparkling. That's what changes the world.
Well, let's do it. Let's do it all together. It's much more fun together than alone, right?
That's right. That's right. That's why you're on this podcast. Great to learn about your journey from hedge fund manager to incarcerated man to life coach and extraordinary being. Thank you for the wisdom that you shared and for all the tips, gratitude, responsibility, and trust that you shared with us. If you enjoyed this podcast, please like, share, subscribe, and rate this podcast. And please go to our website at compassionprisonproject.org, learn about what we're doing, and if you're inspired, please donate. Thank you again for listening, and I'll see you next time.